Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show, halfway through the week. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, great selection of new and pre-owned inventory. And a sales staff that is there for you and not just there for the sale. And a service department that is there for your current vehicle with the diagnostics, the inspections, all the routine maintenance. It's all part of that Sunbury Motors guarantee. And in that great service department, you have many awesome technicians ready to serve you, but SMC is looking for more due to the busy business that a 107-year-old dealership has earned. They're looking for entry-level, experienced technicians to work in their quick lane, car light truck service, heavy truck service, body frame and alignment, and towing departments. Whether you are an experienced technician, an entry-level technician looking for that first job, or maybe you're just looking for a career change, they'd love to hear from you. Stop by in person, apply online at sunburymotors.com, or call Todd at 286-7746. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Another big slate of guests coming up today. Matt Leon from KYW in Philadelphia to talk about this incredible run for Philadelphia sports, which continued with the Phillies 2-0 win against the Padres last night to take a 1-0 series lead in the NLCS. We also have Mike DeCourcy today from Sporting News with the latest on the Big Ten and expansion and where things kind of stand from there. He had some interesting takes on that, so we'll hear from him a little bit later on. And we'll keep it going with the Phillies-Padres series with Heath Bell, the former Padres closer. He'll also join us today, too. So, looking forward to that. This is just an amazing stat with how good Zach Wheeler and Aaron Nola have been for the Phillies. And, of course, Zach Wheeler was brilliant last night. 7 innings, only allowing 1 hit. Only on 83 pitches, I think it was. And I was a little bit surprised by that. To me, I think you got to keep going and save that bullpen up. Now, everybody did the job that came in for the Phillies, but if I'm Rob Thompson, I keep riding, especially your two horses in Wheeler and Nola. If they're on it and they're below 100 pitches, you got to keep them going. That's just me, but still worked out for the Phillies last night anyway. But here's the stat. Zach Wheeler and Aaron Nola combined in the playoffs. Again, combined. 0.84 ERA, 3 earned runs, 32 innings pitched, 29 strikeouts. That is insane. And obviously, a big reason why the Phillies are in this position. Of course, they got game 2 today at 4:07 in San Diego. Your Phillies lineup looks like this. Schwarber in left, Hoskins at first, Realmuto behind the plate, Harper the DH, Castellanos in right field, Bohm at third, Segura at second, Matt Vierling at short today, and Edmundo Sosa at shortstop with Nola on the mound. So a little bit different look for the Phillies this afternoon for their lineup, but those two guys, Sosa in particular, have actually been pretty good for the postseason when their number's been called. So it's looking pretty good right now once again for the Phillies. And if they can win this game tonight, I don't see why they can't sweep the series. I really don't. I just don't think anything's stopping them right now. I think they win the series, of course. My originally said Phillies in six, but I think if the Phillies win tonight, they can very well sweep the series and bring the brooms out this weekend. But nevertheless, assuming they win this series, I don't think anything's stopping them. Between this series and whoever they play in the out of the American League, whether it's the Yankees or the Astros, much as I hate to say it for the Yankees side of things, but I don't think the Yankees are going to be in this much of a... I don't think it's going to be much of a series. Even though I'm happy that they won last night and are moving on, enjoy the celebration, especially with the way things have been the second half of the season, I just don't see it happening for the Yankees. I think you're looking at Phillies-Astros World Series, Steve, and I think the Phillies get it done, and the Astros make the trifecta of losing to NL East teams in the World Series.
The Phillies are playing great.
They're fun to watch. They really are.
Yeah, they are fun to watch. And Wheeler was great last night. Bullpen was great. Harper and Schwarber were great. Really was fun to watch. Meanwhile, Gleyber Torres has to rock the baby at the end of a game. I'm sitting around like, going, you got to be kidding me.
You, sir, are my hero.
Right? A guy that doesn't hustle is doing that. I mean, really. Torres does not play hard.
Maybe he's not the right person, but
no,
that was deserved.
He doesn't play hard, okay?
No. I get it. I get it. He's not the right person to do it.
I don't want people who take their talent for granted, and he does.
Yeah.
Just be happier the next round, because be honest with you, the Yankees have a $211 million payroll advantage over the Indians or the Guardians. 280 to 69.
Yeah.
You should be winning.
Absolutely.
Okay.
He would not be the right person to do it. Plus, he made another stupid error last night in the ninth inning.
Because he doesn't hustle.
Exactly.
He's got a lot of talent, but he's not very good.
But that rock the baby was deserved, though, because you don't do that when you're down
you
one
know what?
In the
do
previous
you know what?
Game.
I don't care how immature the other team is. I don't care about that. See, I'm not into retaliation. Okay, you know how I retaliate?
Win.
5-1.
I know.
Win the damn game. That's how you retaliate. Oh, I'm going to rock that. Yeah, like you had something to do with it. You really didn't have a lot to do with it, Gleyber, as usual. Okay? Just go out and play. I'm not big into it. I think revenge is stupid. I hear that all the time. It's a revenge game. As soon as you get smacked in the mouth or you strike out, guess what? You're not sitting there like, revenge. One of the dumbest things I hear on sports talk radio all the time. It's a revenge game. Really? It is? Yeah. Wow. Big speech in the locker room. You run out. 15 minutes later, you still haven't played. You've got to do the national anthem. Got to do this. Got to do that. Coin toss. Yep. Right? And then all of a sudden you go out in the first play. Bang. Get hit. Now, you may be you delivering the hit, but you're still getting hit. Got to win your battle during the course of the day. Same thing in baseball, right? Oh, I'm all set to go. Revenge. Revenge what? At some point, you got to play the game. Now you're playing situations. Like, I just, the way we cover sports sometimes is just, I sit back and go, the immaturity of it. You know, I don't believe in this stuff. I don't. I never have. Now, I'm going to go rock the baby. Oh, you know what? If I have $280 million and that dude has 69, guess what? I should be winning. Right?
Definitely.
Yeah. You have more resources. All right. So now they got the Astros, Tyone and Verlander tonight.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
Verlander, who was terrific all year, did not pitch well in in his one playoff appearance this year. Did not. And then Tyone is Tyone. Something may be made about the fact the Yankees had to play yesterday. They got to play tonight. So what? Again, so what? You want to talk about a totally irrelevant thing. They got on a charter, and they flew.
I actually think it's a good thing for the Yankees because if they're going to win tonight, they have to keep the bats going. And you can ride the momentum 24 hours ago into tonight's game. So I think it's a good thing they're playing back-to-back. I do.
I mean, but it's no big deal. It's no big deal. No offense. I do football and basketball. Guess what we do? Practice, then fly out the night before the game, play the next day, then fly back. I mean, they're pros, for goodness sakes. That's what they do for a living. No big deal. It's good for the Yankees that Stanton and Judge both homered yesterday in a clinching game. That's big. Somebody sent me about Bonnie Baju. I just sent a return to them about that James and I talked about Bonnie, who's battling cancer.
Yeah, this is a sad story.
Yeah, he's battling it, but James and I talked about it in last week's show. So we have made people aware of it and about the GoFundMe page. So we've actually done that already. But very sad. Believe me, I like Bonnie a lot. That guy worked hard when he was here. Worked very hard. All right. So what do we have? Let's see. Let's see what you have scheduled here today. What do you have scheduled here? Anything? No?
Well, we got Mike DeCourcy today.
Okay, Heath Bell.
We got Heath Bell today, and we got Matt Leon today.
And what time is... we can do anything we want, I guess.
Yeah.
So we'll do Heath Bell next half hour. Get the Padres' perspective on what's going on with the playoffs. We'll get that. Because something tells me, like, the vast majority of people in our audience are thoroughly excited about the Phillies, and you and two other people are excited about the Yankees.
No, senor! No, senor! No, senor!
Actually, you're right about that.
I know. That's why I sit in this chair. As we continue here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
Pitch. Hit on the ground is short. Go to second, force, in time. Ball game over. American League Division Series over. Yankees win. The Yankees win. And the Yankees now go to the American League Championship Series as they face off against the Houston Astros. And we'll have the first game on the air tomorrow night.
Arise!
Was that for the Schwarber home run?
We'll get to that later.
Did he say that for the Bryce Harper home run?
We'll get to them later.
I mean, no, I'm just wondering. I mean, it's like those were like legitimate all rise, like big time on the road, need to win a game kind of deal, as opposed to we have $211 million more and we won. You don't like the $211 million thing, do you? Bugs you.
Yeah, because they haven't lived up to it. That's why it bugs me. But you're saying is fact.
$211 million more. They should be winning this game. So, you should be winning. Oh well. But there's actually football tonight. There's Appalachian State, Georgia State tonight in Boone, North Carolina. America is not captivated. The Phillies are a captivating team to watch. They are fun to watch. They got Nola today against Blake Snell. Good matchup. Except for the play that Bohm made with Stott. Their defense has been much better in the playoffs. And Nola has pitched beautifully, and I thought Wheeler was tremendous. And it goes back to the question I asked Scott Fransky. His ability on the four-seam fastball to spot it high in the zone at 97-98. He has been just tremendous. Wheeler has. And then their bullpen, lights out in the eighth, lights out in the ninth. And you got a couple guys in that lineup that can send it a long way. I know Rhys Hoskins did it against Atlanta. But last night, so important. Harper, team leader. Schwarber, team leader. Long home runs. I mean, not something like Judge hit that barely crawled over the wall. Like big-time hits.
Here's the stat I shared earlier. Wheeler and Nola combined. 0.84 ERA, 3 earned runs in 32 innings, 29 strikeouts.
I mean, that's the 1-2 punch you're looking for. I mean, to go back to Philadelphia up 2-0, wow. That'd be something. That city's already rocking.
If Phillies win tonight, I think you break the brooms out for the weekend.
I mean, meanwhile in New York, they're afraid to get on the subway to go to the game.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory and all, with great warranties. Great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. And a fabulous service department that backs all of it up. Always looking for more technicians, too, to help out. Give Todd a call, by the way, at 286-7746. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online, sunburymotors.com. Phillies today, Aaron Nola. I mean, you really feel like that game at Houston where he pitched and clinched the playoff spot. That's the one where you look at and say, wow, big moment, and he was terrific. Then he gets to the Braves, big moment, he was terrific. You see him out there, feel the same way about him going into this game today. And Blake Snell on the mound. And Blake Snell's been good in this spot in his career. And then the Yankees are the nightcap with the Astros down in Houston. Justin Verlander for the Astros and Jameson Taillon for the Yankees. So with that, let's, you know, we got Scott Fransky's viewpoint on it yesterday. Let's now get the viewpoint from the San Diego side, and let's go out to Southern California to be joined by Heath Bell on the show. Heath, welcome to the show. It's great to have you back.
Hey, thanks for having me back.
All right, so Padres, game one. There are only four hits in the entire game. We could talk about Wheeler was great. Yu Darvish was really good, too. What was your thoughts on game one?
You know, Wheeler was great. I tell people all the time, if you're a starting pitcher and you're going to throw about 100 pitches, if you're, like, on that night and you're kind of, like, so-called perfect, you're going to probably have five mistakes. And usually the other team doesn't hit your mistakes. And Wheeler, I thought, made one mistake, and Will Myers got a base hit up the middle.
Yep.
And the Philly, you know, Yu Darvish made kind of two mistakes, and they just happened to go pretty far. Philly hit some home runs.
My joke earlier today was if the Everett deck wasn't there, the Schwarber home run would have ended up in Mission Valley, where the old ballpark used to be.
If it was at the old Murph. Oh. And it probably hit the freeway.
Oh, so. Yeah, exactly. Exactly, it would have. I did a Holiday Bowl there, so I do know it a little bit. So when you sit there and you look at the lineup that the Padres have, right? We know Soto, Machado. What do they need out of Josh Bell?
They just need him to start making contact a little bit more. I mean, he's... when we got him from the Nationals, he was leading the National League or second in the National League with the most multiple hit games, you know, like getting two more hits per game. And the last month of the season in the playoffs, he just hasn't been doing that. I don't know if it's just a different scenery or different pitching or whatnot, but he hasn't been getting multiple hits. And we could really use Josh Bell getting some hits, multiple hits. That's why we got him. Not, I mean, he has power from both sides, but it's more, you know, getting some hits in the game to get some guys on base and have some other guys drive him in, so or vice versa, or, you know, he would drive like Machado in mm-hmm. or Soto in. So, you know, if we can get him swinging the bat a little bit better, then, you know, we might have a better chance against the Phillies.
How do you look at the matchup? We know what Aaron Nola has done. Nola down the stretch with the scent of a postseason, he's pitched to his credit very well. Give us the update on Blake Snell, whom I thought pitched pretty well against the Dodgers.
Well, Blake Snell's we don't say it very often anymore, like big game pitchers.
Yeah.
I think Blake Snell is that big game pitcher, kind of like the Jack Morris back in the day or the Al Leiter, where you knew that he was going to come up big in a big situation. He was going to dominate all year long. You know, he has good games, bad games, but in the crucial games, he usually steps it up. And people ask all the time, like, why can't you do that 24/7? And it's just different. But I think he's a big game pitcher, and tonight's going to be another probably pitching fest. This might just be a pitching fest series where whoever makes, you know, an error here or walk here, the other team, you know, has to capitalize because there's not going to be any mistakes on the mound very much.
Which gets us to eventually the bullpens in this one. The Phillies bullpen, to its credit, much improved. How, as an expert on this subject, and you are the expert, how do you feel about the Padres bullpen should they be in a spot to win the game?
Padres bullpen reminds me of the days that, like, in 07 when I was there, when we – it was like it didn't matter who was going to be in the game.
Yep.
It didn't have to be our ace. We knew that we were going to put up zeros left and right and every inning. And if somebody didn't have it, somebody was going to come in and bail them out and get a ground ball double play or a strikeout with no outs, bases loaded, and then get a ground ball double play. It just seems like the Padres bullpen knows exactly when to get a strikeout, when to get a ground ball, and it just seems like everything's working for them right now. So it's fun to watch, especially since I'm a bullpen guy.
Yeah. Snell's the kind of guy now that he doesn't have Kevin Cash as a manager, can give you six innings. So,
yeah, definitely.
Sorry, Kevin, but it really wasn't the greatest move. When you look at – we always talk about analytics and going through an order a third time. How do you view that as somebody who's lived it? And obviously, you know, and of course, you know, I mean, you lived it in the bullpen, but how do you now view that going through an order the third time?
So it varies from game to game, because here's the thing, like, you know, Cash pulled Snell out of the game, and I think it cost him the World Series because he was on that day.
Yes.
Nobody was going to hit him that day, but you have some games sometimes that, you know, the first time through a lineup, you say, okay, and the second time, you're like, okay, they're starting to hit him, but he's still getting guys out. But you see it's like he's starting to get hit a little bit. They're not being fooled. Where the third time, they're probably not going to be fooled. But then there's some games where the first two times, the batters are just fooled. Like, they just are swinging a miss, and you just have no idea, or they're getting overpowered. And it doesn't matter the third time through the lineup because the hitters are so frustrated the first two. But it's almost like some pitchers nowadays, it's like, we're going to try to I'm only going to throw you one or two pitches the first time through the lineup. And then the next time the lineup, I'm going to throw you all my pitches. And then that third time through the lineup, you don't have any extra things for him, so the hitter has seen every pitch. But there's some days, like, you know, look at Wheeler last night. It didn't matter if he went three times through the lineup or four times through the lineup.
Agreed.
Guys weren't going to hit the ball because he was that demanding. So that's why I look at, like, look at the pitch count. They always say this, you know, mark of 100 pitches, you know, whatnot. It shouldn't be 100 pitches. It should be how the guy is going. If his pitches are starting to elevate and he's missing the catcher's glove, missing the zone where he wants to throw the ball, pull him out after 60 or 70 pitches. It's okay, because there's going to be some games you probably go 110, 120 pitches. Yeah. But then there's some games that you just don't have it that day, and you're just trying to get four or five innings out of you and just to say, okay, great, I only gave up one run, let's go.
1975 World Series Game 4, Cincinnati. Louis Tiant threw 161 pitches. Oh, and by the way, was the winning pitcher. So, I mean, yeah. You know.
It's the analytics. If you use the analytics as like your, like I always tell pitching analogy, you have to spot your fastball.
Yep.
If you can hit your fastball every single time, like Rivera did it as a closer. You know, he had a little cut fastball. That was it. Nothing really else. But if you have a fastball and you hit your spots, then your breaking ball looks that much better. So if you use the analytics as like your secondary pitch and not your firstary pitch, I think it really helps a lot. But too many times nowadays, I've been watching and seeing in the game the last couple of years, is analytics is number one. And the easiest thing I can go back to is look at, you know, Cash back in when Tampa had Snell, third time through the lineup, we got to get him out. Well, if analytics is real and analytics is true, there's two things that'll happen. One, there'll never be a no-hitter, a perfect game. And two, the Oakland A's should be in first place every single year.
Yes.
Since they grandfathered the whole thing, but
yep,
they're not.
Right.
So it you have to use it as a secondary, as like a helper. You can't use it as your number one. You got to have baseball knowledge, and then you use your secondary with all the analytics. And there you go. It's kind of like the age-old thing that you probably remember and I remember, and this generation doesn't. You always play a guy on his birthday or if he just had a child.
That's right.
For some odd reason, those times, he will have – great things will happen for some reason.
Yep.
And nobody can explain that. There's no numbers. There's no rhyme or reason. It just happens.
I know. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Is there more pressure on hitters – to produce something in the first six innings of a game because bullpens in the postseason have the potential to be so dominant?
You know, it's kind of funny. I would say you're probably – I would say the middle three, kind of like the 4-5-6 or, you know, the 5-6-7 is probably the pressure situation for the hitters.
Yep.
The first time, I don't think the hitters are just trying to get comfortable. They're just trying to, you know, they would love to hit early and then hitting's contagious.
Mm-hmm.
But it's that second third of bat is where, you know, in the beginning, like the leadoff area is like, that's the real pressure of, okay, I got to get a hit here because, you know, next time up or the bottom, you know, if I don't get a hit here, then the bottom of the lineup's going to see our the best bullpen guys out there. So we got to do something here. So I think there's a lot of pressure on the hitters, but I think it's really in the middle lineup, the middle game rather.
Yeah. How much pressure is on the Padres tonight? And look, I know home field means something in the playoffs, but I mean teams have been winning on the road, as we've seen through this. Yeah, the Phillies have been a team, obviously, that's been winning on the road. They've only lost one road game in the playoffs so far. But is there a lot of pressure on the Padres this afternoon because of the situation?
Well, I think you have to have pressure on the situation because you want to win in front of your home. You want to do it. You don't want to have to go down two games to nothing and then go into Philly. Got to win basically every single game to kind of really get back into it, you know, or you're just going to be, you know, neck against the wall. But, you know, I don't think the Padres are down. I think it was like, okay, there was two pitching matchups. The Phillies hitters just did a little bit better than our hitters did. You know, it was close towards the end. We had a chance. We just didn't get a big hit towards the end of the game mm-hmm. in the ninth inning.
Yeah.
But I think these two teams really match up, and I'm loving and watching how, you know, the two wild card teams, the two teams that kind of got into the playoffs are beating everybody, but they're really good. It's not like they're just a fluke. They're really good teams that have had some injuries or had some issues during the season, and that's kind of why they fell off and they didn't win their division. So these are two really good teams that you could see winning or going into the playoffs year in and year out, the Phillies and the Padres. So it's fun to watch, and, you know, I want the Padres to win, and I would love it to go to Game 7 and see what happens.
One last question. It deals with Juan Soto. He was acquired along with Josh Bell for a reason, but Soto was the center of the entire deal to get the Padres over the top. We know what a talent he is and what a great concept he has of the strike zone. Why hasn't it clicked for him? He's had some good moments, but is there also some moments where it's just not quite the same? You feel like it's the same Juan Soto as we saw with Washington.
You know what I think? My only take on it is, you know, in Washington this year, he didn't really want to be there, so he just decided and he didn't have a whole lot of protection besides Bell, and Bell kind of raised his game this year. Yeah. Is he was just going to, you know, take a bunch of walks, and that'll be fine. And then he gets traded to San Diego, and he tried to – at first he was fine the first couple of games, and then after that he really didn't get a hit. I think he tried to do too much, swing more often than he was comfortable with the last couple months. And now he's kind of in that transition where should I swing, should I not swing? Because some great hitters, they'll go out of the zone to hit a ball to get a base hit the other way or to hit that home run or something like that. Or like Guerrero will go way down and get one. You know, you don't hear any two more like bad ball hitters. But I just think he's been so patient this year and last year with Washington that it's kind of hard to change a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think maybe he's trying a little too much. Where this year, I mean, unfortunately, he was just not being pitched to. So he didn't swing a lot and didn't swing at those pitches that were right on the border, and he was getting those calls. And now he has to swing at those pitches because he can't always walk. You know, the Padres need him to swing the bat and get some hits. So it's just one of those times. Like sometimes, you know, Bryce Harper is just tearing it up and having an all-star year, and then there's mm-hmm. sometimes that has more power than others. You know, he's hitting for average this year and hitting for power another year, and it's kind of a rhythm thing. So, and I just think he was in a rhythm of walking, and we kind of need him to get some hits. So he's trying to do the best of both.
Well, you're a hit with the audience, so I appreciate the time you gave us very much today, Heath. Enjoy it today.
Thanks, and have a good one.
Yeah, I want to take a moment to apologize to you.
And why is that?
Well, we did a segment, and we actually talked about what the audience wanted to hear. All right, we'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
You guys know, unless it's like a season-ending injury, I typically don't announce that. Also, it's Tuesday. We haven't even practiced yet, so it's hard for me to give you guys an answer that helps you do your job at this stage. But yeah, nothing has changed with the plan or the model at this stage.
Another answer that made you mad.
Nah, this one I saw coming. It is what it is. I didn't expect an answer. But obviously monitor.
Was that on Sean or on Landon?
That was on Sean.
Landon or Sean?
Yeah, that was on Sean.
And what was the answer that PJ Fleck gave on Tanner Morgan?
I think it was the same thing.
Oh, I'm surprised. Oh, I'm shocked.
Yeah, but two things to monitor this week, that's all.
No, I've already monitored it. All right. So, right? So. Yeah. Very interesting. All right. So we'll see how it plays out. By the way, the ratings are in for the NFL over the weekend. The Eagles and the Cowboys, 20.7 million viewers. How about that?
Can't say I'm surprised.
Yeah, Bills and Chiefs, 25.4 million. 5 million tuned out when your game came on. All right, so that's a stubby. It's a game everybody wanted to watch. But you've got to be able to spread the wealth. I mean, CBS needs a game in that spot. Fox needs a game in that spot. Right? They can't all be Sunday Night Football. And everybody knew going in, as emotional as you get about Eagles, Cowboys, you know, it's like the Bills and the Chiefs was the game everybody wanted to watch.
Oh, no question. I acknowledge that.
And it turned out to be true. I mean, 5 million more people watched that game. I mean, you know, you're talking about, and when I mean 5 million more, that is a huge increase percentage wise. Because, I mean, the Bills and the Chiefs, what they've delivered over recent years is just great theater, and I don't think it helps the theater, with all due respect to a nice story that Cooper Rush is the quarterback.
Oh, yeah, no question at all.
I mean, that's a big part of it, too. It's like, if you got Dak Prescott, you know, it's got a little more cachet. Prescott, Jalen Hurts, right? The Cooper Rush, with all due respect, again, you're a backup quarterback for a reason. It doesn't draw in. Now you got Allen and Mahomes head-to-head and put together really another. And not only that, it was a terrific game. Fun game to watch. All right. Mike DeCourcy next half hour. And his conversation with Kevin Warren.